We have a recording. So, let's see. Here. Key is not here. It's a bit easier to say who is here. Barnes is here. Kester or Harrison is here. And Kesterson is here in bed. Online, we have, let's see, Paula. And again, if you're online, don't forget to send the words in. Despite that reminder, there's a handful of you who just never send the words in. So again, you are considered absent if you don't send the words in. This is an in-person course. I like to stream it and record it to give some flexibility, but if you're not here and you don't send the words in, there's nothing I can do for you. Anyway, who else is here? King is here, or online. Let's see. James is online. Grace is online. Morrison is online. Parks is online. Linda Q and Bonner are also online. Don't forget, your lab is due today, the natural selection lab. Obviously, you should have already done the pre-lab before you did the lab, but just in case, make sure you do that video, the natural selection video, before you do the rest of the lab. I guess that's really my only advice for that. Other than that, just to remind you, I'll be having office hours until noon today. If you need me, please let me help you. What else? Friday before Veterans Day, I will not be having office hours. And then Veterans Day itself, we will not be meeting in person. We will only be meeting online. And again, plan B, if something goes wrong, then I'll just provide another video for you. Like I said, if I don't have a plan B, then something will go wrong. But since we have a plan B, nothing will go wrong. But yes. So if you go to find me on Monday morning on November 11th, and I'm not online or something's just up, then don't worry about it. Just go about your day, and I will figure it out once I get things working. But anyway, does anybody have any questions for your own announcements that you want to share?
I got a question.
Yes, sir.
Why do you like it so dark in here?
I don't necessarily like it dark in here. It's just that, you want to turn the lights on?
No, not really.
I just figured if it's lights are on, it's probably too bright to see. Uh-huh. So that's it. Oh, and also, since September 21st, it gets darker and darker.
Yeah.
Every time, you know. So didn't start like this. Anyway, any other questions? All right. So let's go back to where we left off. We were talking about translation. So remember, most of this chapter is about going from DNA to protein, right? And so to do that, we go from DNA to RNA, which is transcription. Then we go from RNA to protein, which is translation. And this is where we left off talking about, right? So first, we wanted to talk about the parts, or as your old textbook called the players of this concept, right? So this is where we left off talking about. We finished talking about the fact that ribosomes, which are the machines, if you want to call them that, the cellular machinery, and make the proteins themselves. They're made up of two subunits, and I told you I might ask you that, I might not ask you that, I'm not sure. Also, they're made up of a different type of RNA, so again, that is the third and final type of RNA that I'm teaching you about, which is ribosomal RNA, rRNA, and protein, right? So you definitely need to know what rRNA is, but I may or may not ask you what ribosomes are made of. You know, so in other words, you definitely need to know what rRNA is, but you might or might not need to remember that there's proteins also involved. Anyway, these ribosomes have a binding site, obviously, because they're bringing everything together. So they have a binding site for the mRNA on the small subunit and a binding site for the tRNA on the large subunit. And that should make sense to you. Because again, this ribosome is bringing all the parts together. So obviously you need the mRNA because you need the code. You need the tRNA because you need it to bring in those amino acids so it can build a protein. So that should make sense. So one thing I'm definitely not going to ask you, so I'm going to put it next to this. You definitely need to know that that stuff binds to the RNAs, but I'm not going to ask you to remember which one binds to the smallest subunit and which one binds to the large subunit. The first word for attendance will be Lewis, like the name Lewis, L-E-W-I-S. Lewis. All right, so here's what we're talking about. Now, I'll point this out too. This is from the old textbook, and I believe the textbook that you use has a similar looking picture. You'll notice later in this chapter, or in this slideshow, I'm gonna show you a different version, and there's actually gonna be three sites. So yes, I'm teaching you a very simplified version. There is a more complicated version. So if you're looking up other stuff, like for example, for independent work, which you guys should be doing, then you might notice that there is a third site. Just remember, this is the version you need to know. This is the easier version. And we're also gonna talk about how everything works, but again, remember now we're just talking about the parts. So these are the parts, right? This is the ribosome. Like I said, there's a large subunit and a small subunit. This ribosome is made up of rRNA and protein. Again, like I said earlier, the mRNA binds to the small subunit and the tRNA binds to the large subunit. And again, I'm not going to ask you that, but there it is. So that's what it looks like when all the parts aren't together. But when all the parts are together, this is what it looks like. Again, you have the rRNA right there, excuse me, the ribosome, which is made up of rRNA. You have the mRNA attached to it, right? That's that ribbon right there, that red ribbon. And of course you have the tRNA, each one with its specific amino acid, right? So it reads its code, it brings in its specific amino acid, and eventually that thing is going to attach to that growing strand, and the whole process will go on. And of course, I'm going to get into more detail about that later, but for now, these are just the parts. So you can see all the parts there, right? The ribosome, the mRNA, the tRNA, the amino acids. Only thing this is not showing, and we're also not even going to really consider it for the exam, I might mention it every once in a while, is the fact that this requires energy, right? So this is not showing the energy, but like the ATP. But again, this is a simplified version, so we don't need to worry about that. Any questions about the parts for translation?
Does the polypeptides come out of the tRNA? Come out like a flower that came out?
No, I'll explain that in the next few slides. Right now, you can kind of see how it starts. Like here's just here's a polypeptide, which is nothing but a chain of amino acids, right?
Yeah.
And here comes a new one. And like I said, I drew that arrow. This thing is going to be attached to that strand. So it's just going to grow longer and longer. Every time a new tRNA is going to bring in a new amino acid, and it'll get attached, and it'll get longer.
But it is coming out of the tRNA.
Yeah, it's attached to I wouldn't say it's coming out of the tRNA. The tRNA is holding it.
Oh, holding it.
Yeah, it's like bringing it in. Like imagine this is empty, right? So the tRNA comes in, holding it, just like you can see right here. It's just at the top of it, it's attached to it.
Okay.
And then it just kind of sits in there. And again, this will make more sense as we move forward and talk about the process of translation. Here's the good news. For once, something is a little bit easy for students. So translation itself is broken down into three stages. Just like you need to know the three stages of transcription, you need to know the three stages of translation. And as far as nomenclature is concerned, they're the same. They have the same names. Initiation, elongation, and termination. I'm not going to waste as much time as I did Wednesday, but let's see who's thinking, who might be able to guess this. What must be the first step? What is initiation? What do you think that entails? Think about this logically. You know I've told you what all the parts are, and you've even seen how they go together. So what do you think the first stage is? What do you think initiation might be? Any guesses? And it really is common sense. This is, I think, is very logical and straightforward.
This is where it's going to start.
That is, yep, it's where it starts. And in a sense, it's very similar. Well, in one sense, it's exactly similar to transcription. Because in transcription, the RNA polymerase attaches to the DNA. And another way of saying that is all the parts come together. So that's what happens here. All the parts come together. Initiation brings all the stuff together. So you've got the mRNA that comes in and attaches to the ribosome. You've got that first tRNA that has its amino acid that comes into the ribosome. Right, so basically, again, all the parts come together for initiation. That's what it is. Pretty simple, right? All the parts come together. And just to remind you, this is what it looks like. The mRNA that we're dealing with, there's a cap, there's a tail. Even though I'm not going to get this detailed into the on the exam. But yeah, so that's like the promoter, right? That's where it knows the start. That's where it ends. And now I'll actually give you the proper words for those later. And then there's the genetic code in the middle. But for now, that's enough, right? That's that mRNA that you're familiar with. And again, initiation just brings all these things together. And I do like this picture. This picture is not from your textbook, nor is it from the old textbook. Like I said, see, some of them show three sites because there actually are three sites. But anyway, you don't necessarily need to study this picture, but the reason I like it is because it shows that first, like when I say everything comes together, well, it comes together in a certain order. So first, as you can see on the left there, the bottom left, the mRNA attaches to that small subunit. Then that first tRNA says, oh, that's it. That's my code. I'm coming in. Right? So then it attaches where its codon is. Then the large subunit comes in, and now all the pieces are together. I might ask you to know that in that order, but probably not.
Is GTP an energy release?
Sure is. Good question. And that's another reason I like that picture. So, you know, in this class, in this 100 level non-biology major class, it's ATP, ATP, ATP. And remember, the A in ATP is adenosine, right? So it's just one of the four nucleotides that we use in DNA. A's, C's, T's, and G's, that's the A. And in here, the GTP, similar thing. It's just another one of the nucleotides. It's the G and the A's, G's, C's, and T's of DNA. And just this one also happens to be a triphosphate. But yeah, again, that picture is not from your textbook or the other one, so you don't need to know about this. It's just nice to have it out there in the back of your mind. Now, if you want to, you can look that up too for independent work, because you know how ATP is made. You spent a whole chapter on it talking about cellular respiration. So you could ask yourself, well, is GTP made the same way? Like, does it follow the same rules? Or is GTP made just as often as ATP? Like, is it just depending on which nucleotide happens to be present? Stuff you can look into if you want. One thing I'm definitely going to ask you about on this exam is this middle bullet point, specifically this. So just like I asked where transcription happens, and the answer is the promoter, which I think I accidentally said to a previous slide, which was the wrong thing to say. Still waking up, waiting for my coffee to kick in. So anyway, just like transcription starts at the promoter, translation starts at the start codon. Just nice and easy. That's easy to remember. The hard part is remembering, all right, this is the start codon, transcription or translation, because really that word could be used for either one, right? Because in transcription, you're still dealing with codons. Translation, we're dealing with codons as well. So yep, that's where it starts, start codon. So again, initiation, all the parts come together, and they come together in this order. First, the mRNA attaches to the small subunit of the ribosome. Then that first tRNA with its amino acid comes in. Then the large subunit comes in. And this all starts at the TNA, or the start codon. Are there any questions about this slide before I show you a more simplified picture than what we have here? All right, so this is from the old textbook. You can see it's a little simpler, but still showing the same thing for the most part, right? The mRNA attaches to the small subunit. The tRNA comes in because the first tRNA comes in and reads it and says, oh, that's my code. That's me. I come in. Then the rest of it comes in, right? You have the large subunit that comes in, and now all parts together. There are some details, too, that I think your textbook might point out, so I'm only going to mention it just so you know I'm not glossing it over. But the first amino acid is always this one. It's always MET, but I'm not going to ask you to know that. And the code, well, obviously, you would need to know the code for MET, but that this is one of them, right? And again, I'm not going to ask you to know that. But the fact that every time you see the picture of it, that they show that particular amino acid and that particular code, that's for a reason. It's because it's real. And again, I don't remember how much detail your textbook goes into talking about that, but I personally, I'm not going to ask you about that on the exam. What else to tell you about this slide before we move forward? And again, notice too that this simplified version doesn't even show you the GTP, the energy source. We know it needs energy to bring all these pieces together, but as far as the exam is concerned, we're not worried about it. So any questions about this slide? All right, if you download the PowerPoint, you can watch this little animation. This shows all the translation happening. But here we go. Actually, before we get into it, elongation. What do you basically think happens in elongation? Or let me reword the question, because this is something you definitely should know. I'm not going to get too specific here. This can be very broad. In elongation, what are we elongating? So, for example, in transcription, elongation is we were elongating the RNA, right? We were making a strand of RNA. So, for elongation in translation, what are we elongating? What are we making a strand of? And by now, you should know this because I've said it a lot. You've seen it a lot. You should know the overall purpose of transcription and translation. And you even asked, Kesterson even asked a question slightly about this. So what are we making a strand of?
RNA.
I like
mRNA.
That.
mRNA.
We have already made that. Yeah, that's good because we need the mRNA, right? We've already made that in transcription. Transcription, that was the whole purpose of transcription, was to make that mRNA, and we've done it. Now we're using that mRNA to make a strand of?
DNA.
And here's a hint, like I keep saying, study the big picture first. So we're going, for this whole chapter, right, we're going from DNA to RNA to, I hope you guys know this and you're just too shy to say it. DNA to RNA to, I'm worried.
Polypeptide?
Yes, thank you. DNA to RNA to protein. DNA to RNA to protein. DNA to RNA to protein. DNA to RNA to polypeptides. DNA to RNA to a strand of amino acids. However you want to say it. We've been saying it a lot. I think you guys knew that and you just don't want to say anything. I'm hoping that's it. But anyway, let's talk about it. Elongation is when amino acids are added one by one, right? So we're making a strand of amino acids one at a time, bringing in this amino acid and attaching it to that one. Then we're going to bring in another amino acid and attach it to that one, like so on and so forth. We are making a strand of amino acids, which is polypeptide. And once you fold that polypeptide into its correct shape, it is considered protein. But remember, for this chapter, I'm not even going to get that specific, right? In this chapter, we can use the word protein and polypeptide and even string of amino acids interchangeably. But here's where it gets a little bit sucky for you guys. Because the elongation itself, which is one of the three stages of translation, is also broken down into a three-step process. So let's talk about this. Step one is the codon recognition. In other words, that's where the tRNA says, remember, there's 20 different, well, there's more than that. There's specific tRNAs with specific codes, and they have their specific amino acid. So step one is that tRNA saying, oh, that's me. That's me, and that needs my amino acid. So I'm going to come over there, and I'm going to attach. Codon recognition, step one. And, of course, if you talk about it technically, you would say the anticodon of the tRNA pairs with the mRNA codon in the A side of the ribosome. But I'm not going to use terms like anticodon, codon. Like, you don't need to remember that the anticodon is on the tRNA, and the codon is in the mRNA. And you don't need to know that this happens in the A site. Just know that the first step is basically, the tRNA saying, oh, that's me. I'm coming in with my amino acid, which makes sense. Now, looking at this picture, and I'm not going to wait a long time for this one because the last one I was a little bit worried that nobody knew the answer to. This one, it's logical, but it's not straightforward. So let's see if anyone can guess it. And I don't feel bad if you can't. So again, step one, imagine if this was animated. Step one would be this thing going bloop, right? Landing right there in the A site. That would be step one. So then what do you think step two would be? You have to guess. And again, imagine in your brain, instead of this thing moving towards here, imagine it being here. Imagine it sitting here, right? And it's got its one amino acid sitting up top. And then there's a strand of amino acids right next to it. And this process is called elongation because we're trying to elongate that strand of amino acids. What do you think the next step might be?
It's got to be bonded together.
Yes. Great. That is correct.
Covalent.
Yep. And I'm not even going to ask that in the exam, but yes, it is a covalent bond. Yeah. So yes, step two, after this tRNA has already come in, because that was step one, right? Now this gets added to the growing strand. Or more specifically, and I'm not going to get this specific on the exam, technically, you can see here, the growing strand kind of gets added to the new amino acid. Depending on how you look at it, right? That's all semantics in a way.
These are coming from an outside source, right?
Yeah, they just kind of float around in the cytoplasm. You've got all these tRNAs floating around with their specific amino acids, and then they come in.
Could there be problems with that, like mutations?
Yeah, and your textbook doesn't talk too much about, when it talks about mutations, it generally focuses on code. So a mutation with the code in the DNA, the A's, the C's, the T's, and the G's, and we're actually going to talk about that at the end of this chapter. But what they don't talk too much about is this. But yeah, that's, imagine all the things that could go wrong. So for example, maybe, you know, again, the tRNA is very specific. It has a very specific anticodon. And then that specific anticodon means it's supposed to have a very specific amino acid. So there's one place it could go wrong, right? What if that happens? If it happens to have the wrong amino acid attached to it. Or what happens if the tRNA is fine, but it just misreads the code. And it's supposed to, like, it was supposed to call for a different, right? Here's a, what's called a diamond amino acid, right? Which it isn't, but whatever. Let's call it a diamond amino acid. That code called for a diamond amino acid. But what if it called for a circle amino acid instead, and that was just a mistake? Which is a great thing to look into for independent work if you want. And again, you could just do it for one point where you just like look it up and like, so what are the other types of mutations? Or are there any mistakes in translation? That is another way to put it. So you can just email me, yes, there are, and this is what it is, and you know, copy it, paste it, get your one point. Or if you want to, you can write a paper about it. But yes, that's a great question.
Is there enzymes that eliminates the problem peptide?
Like the mistakes?
Yeah, the mistakes.
I don't actually remember that, which is another great question. It goes along with the previous question, right? So first of all, what kind of mistakes can happen here? And second of all, how do the cells deal with it? Like you said, are there amino acids that then digest it? And there are digestive organelles too in the cell that digest things. So those are all things you can look into for independent work. But yes, again, we're talking about translation. Translation is broken down into three stages: initiation, elongation, termination. And then now we're talking about elongation. And elongation is broken down into three steps. We've talked about the first step, which was codon recognition. And we just got finished talking about the second step, which is peptide bond formation. In other words, it's just we're making the strand of amino acids a little bit longer. We're elongating the polypeptide. So any questions? Actually, yeah, first, yeah, are there any questions about this slide before we go on to step three? All right, so remember, we need to keep growing and growing and growing this, right? We're not going to have a peptide, a polypeptide with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 amino acids, right? It's going to be a lot longer than that. So that being said, can you guess what might happen in step three? And again, don't feel bad if you don't get this. The other one you should have known that elongation is elongating a polypeptide, because that's what we're after here. But this one, again, don't feel bad if you don't know, but can anybody guess what might happen in step three?
It's going to separate.
Perfect, yes. We still need that RNA, we still need that ribosome. We need that stuff to be gone, because we need to keep moving, so yes. Once that peptide bond formation has occurred, then that tRNA is now useless because it's already gotten rid of its amino acid, and it just separates. And then this one switches over and moves over to the previous spot. leaving this spot open. So the whole thing can happen again. So basically, it's a cycle, and this is what it looks like. Elongation is a cycle. Step one, codon recognition. It comes in with its amino acid. Step two, that chain of amino acids then attaches to that amino, the new amino acid. Step three, the empty tRNA is now done. It just leaves in a good independent word question. What happens to that empty tRNA? Is it just disintegrated, or does it go find its the correct amino acid again and get attached? Basically, I'm asking, is that recycled, or is it used once and it's done? So you can look that up for independent word. Anyway, it leaves. Now this thing needs to move over because we need that spot open, so it moves over here. And then at that point, we've gone back to where we started. Any questions about elongation of translation? Let me see something real quickly here. Excuse me, making sure we're still recording, because like I said, it has not been working for us. Hey, it seems to be working. Hopefully everybody online can hear me. I know that was a thing too. Anyway, we are recording. What did I say the word, first word for, I said Lewis? Okay, so the second word for attendance is puller. P-U-L-L-E-R. Puller. Try to write here. Technically, that should be an uppercase P. That is a proper noun. It's a last name. Anyway, if there's no questions about elongation, let's move forward. And can anybody remember the third? Again, we're done with elongation. We started initiation, done. Elongation, done. Does anybody remember the name of the third step, third stage? And it's the same as it was the transcription.
Who's Puller? Is that a guy or something? A scientist?
Yep. Well, it's not a scientist. We'll get there. Anyway, no guesses what's next? This is something you should remember. Hopefully, once again, you're just too shy to say. Initiation, elongation, then I'll be back. It's the same as it was in transcription. The last stage of transcription is?
Termination.
Thank you. Termination. And just like in transcription termination, you had to know where it ended, and it ended in transcription at the terminator. Here is stop. It ends at the stop codon. Which is good. That works, right? At least it's easier to remember because translation started at the start codon and it ends at the stop codon. That should be easy to remember for the exam. Again, the hard part is going to be remembering that start and stop codon is in reference to translation and not transcription. Because, you know, we also deal with transcription and obviously the codons and transcriptions. But yeah, this is where it happens. The stop codon is always a UAA, a UAG, or a UGA. Your book included that, so did I. But I'm going to put an X to that because I'm not going to ask you about that. But yes, so anytime that code comes up, the whole process stops. And later, when we talk about the mutations that Kesterson was asking about, that is one of the common mutations. Sometimes, when the mRNA is being made, it's made incorrectly, right? So it doesn't follow the DNA code perfectly, and it brings in the wrong nucleotides, and it has the wrong code. And one of the mutations is called a premature stop codon. And this is going to be a question on the exam, too. What happens if you get a premature stop codon? Well, you get a shorter polynucleotide. Good grief. Not polynucleotide, but polypeptide. You get a shorter protein, a shorter string of amino acids. Because once this code is reached, once that something reads that code on the mRNA, it's like, all right, we're done here. Anyway, the stop codon does not code for an amino acid. It just stops the process. I'll put a line through that first part because you don't necessarily need to know that. You definitely need to know that the stop codon does stop translation. But yeah, it doesn't code for an amino acid, which is interesting slightly because remember, the start codon actually did bring an amino acid. I told you it was always the MET amino acid, but I also told you didn't need to know that. But yeah, it is slightly interesting in that the start codon includes an amino acid. The stop codon does not. Once this has happened, The completed polypeptide is free, and basically everything is free. So now that we're done with the process, everything goes away. And I like this picture. Once again, this is not from your textbook. This is from a more more intricate textbook, more in depth. Again, you can see here that we actually have three sites. This one's got three sites, and we never even talk about that because your textbook talks about two. Here we have something called the release factor, which, if I remember correctly, your textbook definitely doesn't talk about. I know for a fact the old textbook doesn't talk about it. You can look into it for independent work if you want. What's the release factor? Also notice, too, that unlike your textbook, I think, and definitely unlike NASA's, but notice it goes from 5' to 3'. Notice once again that this is requiring energy. And notice again, this picture is showing GTP. So again, that's something you need to look into. Is that on accident? Is this the author of this textbook just like to draw the GTP instead of the ATP? Or do we specifically need GTP for this process as opposed to ATP? Anyway, all independent work stuff. Not important for the exam. For the exam, what you need to know is termination is the last stage of translation. And in that, everything is free. All the parts are released. And it is started, right? Termination happens because of something called the stop codon, which says stop what you're doing, everything go away. Anyway, any questions about termination?
Can we measure the time between initiation to termination? Does it fluctuate?
I think it's pretty steady, and that's something else you could look up for independent work. It's very quick, too. Very quick. Like, you'll see, and some, if you download the PowerPoint and watch those animations, you look at it, and like, that's happening pretty quickly. But in all actuality, as quick as that looks, it's also slowing it down so we can see it. This is happening very quickly. Which goes back to one of your other questions about the mistakes, you know, happening so quickly. Sometimes mistakes are made. Another thing you can look into if you really want to dive deep into it is how does temperature affect it? Because these are chemical reactions, right? Yeah. We need all these parts to come in and go to the right spot, you know, at the right time. So therefore, we need all those parts floating around in the cytoplasm. Therefore, the warmer things are, the quicker they're moving around, which might be helpful because then you're more likely to get the part you need. And then again, if they're moving too quickly, like when they move so quickly that they don't need, they hit it, but they're moving so quick that they can't bond, right? So there's all kinds of things to look into. What's the optimal temperature for this to happen? What happens if it's too hot? What happens if it's too cold? Or his question, how fast does this happen? How many mistakes are there? What are the mistakes, right? All these things that I'm asking you, you can look up for independent work. Because I'm not going to ask you on the exam. It's just things to think about. And then again, remember earlier I was saying one of the questions we could ask is what happens to this tRNA that goes away, right? The tRNA gave its amino acid. It's now without an amino acid, and that's its job, is to carry an amino acid. So what happens to that tRNA, right? That's what I asked. Now I'm asking you a similar question. What happens to this mRNA? We're done with it. We read the code. We made the protein from it. Now what happens to it? Does it just float around in your cytoplasm? Does another ribosome pick it up and then, you know, make the same protein? Does it get destroyed by something in your cells? If so, what does the destroying? Same thing, you could ask the same thing for any of those parts, right? What happens to the ribosome, right? Is it just done now, or is it going to get reused? All things you can look up for in the paper. So, really quickly. And again, this is why I teach out of the old textbook. I love the old textbook for this. First, we had like a big overview, right? We looked at the whole thing going from DNA to RNA to protein, big picture. Then we dug deep and looked at the individual steps, right? We got deeper. And now that we're done with it, we're going to take another step back and review everything that we already know. You know, let's go through it very quick. Again, memorize this. And again, I hope you guys memorize this. You were just too shy to say it. But this is number one. If you forget everything else in this chapter, remember this first. We are going from DNA to RNA to protein. Memorize that first, right? The whole thing, almost this entire chapter, is going to talk about making protein. Again, we also talked about DNA duplication. Most of it's been talking about making protein. So remember, we go from DNA to RNA to protein. Then, once you have that memorized, you can memorize the fact that going from DNA to RNA, that first step is called transcription. Right? And then once you have that memorized, then all right, remember going from RNA to protein is called translation. Then you can start adding details. For example, transcription happens in the nucleus, translation happens outside of the nucleus. And of course, this is all in eukaryotic organisms because prokaryotes don't have nuclei. But yeah. Also memorize the fact that the RNA, mRNA to be exact, is processed before it leaves the nucleus because it needs a cap, it needs a tail, and it needs to be spliced, right? So we need the cap and the tail for protection and so that the mRNA, or excuse me, the ribosome can recognize the mRNA. And then, oh, here's some new information for you. And here you go. This is Kesterson's question. And here's the textbook answer. But again, you can still look this up and find maybe a more specific answer. Translation happens when one ribosome, excuse me, one translation happens, one ribosome can make an average size polypeptide in less than a minute. Which also brings up other questions. What is the average size polypeptide? Meaning, remember, a polypeptide is nothing but a chain of amino acids. So the question is, or the answer would be X amount of amino acids. Like it's 1,000 amino acids long or 1,000,000 amino acids long. But yeah, stuff to look into, right? And again, not that I'm going to ask you that, so it's a good time, good reminder for me to put a line through that. I'm not going to ask you how long that takes. And again, and I'm probably not going to ask you this, but I have been mentioning it throughout this chapter. Technically, polypeptides and proteins mean different things, right? A protein is a polypeptide, but it's only a polypeptide that's been folded into its correct shape, right? Once it's folded into its correct three-dimensional shape, we then consider a polypeptide a protein. For the purposes of this chapter and this exam, we can use the word polypeptide and protein and string of amino acids. All three of those terms in this context mean the same thing. So any questions about this slide? Again, this is an overview. There's nothing new out there other than what I drew a line through. And that's stuff I'm not going to ask you. All right, here's a picture of everything we're talking about. There's your DNA. It's in the nucleus. That's your master copy. You don't want to take your DNA outside, right? You want to keep it in the nucleus where it's safe. Plus, you don't need the whole chromosome. You only need that one gene. So in comes RNA polymerase. It attaches to the promoter, which is not being shown. It opens up the DNA and reads the code, and it makes this strand of mRNA one at a time, right? It brings in one nucleotide at a time because it's reading that DNA code, and it brings in the opposite. So if the DNA has a C, it brings in a G. If the DNA has a G, it brings in a C. If the DNA has a T, it brings in an A. If the DNA has an A, it brings in a U, right? So one at a time, it does the opposite. And it grows and grows and grows. You can see here this mRNA has some introns, which remember is the in-between stuff. And as far as we're concerned, to keep things simple, we're going to call it junk. But it's not quite junk. So we need to get rid of it. This mRNA is not ready to go. So we give it a cap and a tail for protection and for recognition. We get rid of the introns with the splicing. Now it's ready to go. It leaves the nucleus. I like this. Again, this picture's from the old textbook. I do like this because even though we didn't talk about it, and I'm not going to ask you about it, this is showing that there is a process, right? Here we have a TNA that doesn't have its correct amino acid, but something has to bring that together, and there we go. We have an enzyme that brings together the tRNA and the amino acid. And of course, that requires energy, which is a good test question, or not test question, a good independent work question. There's a ton of them, right? You can look that up for 1 point. What enzyme does this? What enzyme attaches the amino acid to the tRNA? And is it a specific enzyme for each specific tRNA? Right? Because remember, there's a different tRNA. There's different ones, and there's 20 different amino acids, so that's something you can look into for the exam. Anyway, I will put a big X to this just to remind you, I'm not going to ask you about that on the exam. Then here we go. We have translation. All the parts come together, right? Initiation of translation is all the parts come together. If this was showing it, if this was animated first, you would see that mRNA attached to that small subunit. Then you would see this tRNA come in with its MET amino acid, and it would attach there. Then you would see the large subunit come in. That's initiation. Now we're ready for elongation. So in comes another tRNA into that A spot, which again, I'm not gonna ask you the name of that spot, but yes, it comes in. Now that growing amino acid strand is ready to attach to that new amino acid, so it does. At which point the other tRNA is now useless, so it disappears, so much so in fact that it didn't even show it. The other tRNA moves in, that whole thing happens again, and then at the end, at termination, we come to the stop codon, all the parts are released, and there we are. So, any questions about that picture? It's a great picture to study. And again, if you do, just remember, I'm not going to ask you about amino acid attachment. All right, so again, transcription and translation is how, or are how, genes control the structures and activities of cells. So structures, because again, the whole thing is that protein, right? We're trying to make protein. The end result of transcription and translation is protein. So we're after protein. But as a reminder, and we said this at the beginning of the chapter, I'm saying it again, sometimes the protein is just for stuff, right? We need the protein. We need maybe a cytoskeleton. We need the protein for its structure. But also very often, we need the protein because it's an enzyme, and it lets other chemical reactions happen. So for example, well, what's the example that I use? All right, remember when we talked about blood groups, A, B, O, those blood groups, and I said, your blood group is dictated because there's a carbohydrate on the surface of your cell, and this is one example. Obviously, we're not making carbohydrates here, right? We're going from DNA to RNA to protein, but we do need an enzyme to help make those carbohydrates, right? So even though we're only making protein here, in this particular example that I'm giving, that protein is the thing that's going to be used to make that carbohydrate. So when your cell needs something, even if it's not a protein, it still needs the enzyme to make that thing, therefore it will need the protein. So that's how your genes work, right? Every single one of your genes makes a protein. Sometimes that protein is used because that's what your cell needed, or sometimes that protein is used as a machine to make something else that the cell needs. Anyway, again, the information originates with a specific sequence of nucleotides in the DNA gene, right? The A's, the C's, the T's, and the G's. Those are the letters in that language. And when they're put together in different variations, just like it is in the English language, that makes words, right? So the information is written in those letters in the DNA. That gene dictates the transcription of a complementary sequence of nucleotides in the mRNA. So again, it's just what I'm saying there is if the DNA says CCC for the word, then the RNA is going to be GGG, right? Because it's complementary. That mRNA sequence, in this example, the GGG that I just talked about, specifies the sequence of amino acids in a polypeptide. So again, the GGG says bring me this amino acid. CTC or CUC says bring me that amino acid, right? There's just every one of these three-letter words says bring me this amino acid, bring me that amino acid. And then finally, the proteins from the polypeptides determine the appearance and capabilities of the cell organism. So again, that goes back to this bullet point right here, goes back to this right here. Controls the proteins, right? We've got proteins that are either the structure or the activities of the cells. So it's very important. So again, whatever it is that your cells need, even if it's not a protein, they still need a gene for it because the gene, in that case, will dictate how to make the enzyme, you know, the particular protein. And that enzyme can then make whatever it is your cell needs. Any questions about that? All right. Again, we're still reviewing here. So DNA to RNA to protein, that pathway was believed to be the only way that genetic information controls traits. But there are recent discoveries that are kind of saying that it's not quite that simple. So it's still true, but it's not as universal and as we used to think it is. You can look at chapter 11 if you want. We're going to skip chapter 11, but you can read it. And if I get time, and I don't think I will, but if I get time, I might come up, make a quiz for chapter 11, and share that with you guys for extra credit. But yeah, any questions about the overall big picture? All right. I don't know why I just thought of this, but just so you guys know, today is National Vinegar Day. And that is actually related to biology. You can look this up for independent work if you want. Because vinegar is an interesting thing. It takes sugar, and it breaks it down in a process called fermentation that you guys are already familiar with, and it uses yeast to break it down, and that makes alcohol, as you already know. But then it gets a little bit more interesting because then it uses bacteria to turn that alcohol into something called acetic acid. And you guys are already familiar with acetic acid, right? Because we talked about that in the study of respiration. So I find vinegar interesting for that reason, right? You've got eukaryotes, you've got the yeast doing the first part, and you've got bacteria doing the second part. So anyway, sorry for the sidetrack, but you can look that up for independent work if you want. National Vinegar Day. Also National Cinnamon Day, but that's more of a chemistry thing, in my opinion. No, I take that back. That could be an independent work question, too. How did that cinnamon tree, or for what purpose, did it evolve that strong flavor? Because it wasn't on accident. That flavor of cinnamon that humans enjoy is actually, it serves a purpose other than to please humans. So you can look that up. Anyway, let's see, 843 mutations. So the last word for attendance is going to be chesty, C-H-E-S-T-Y. We'll bring all that together. We have a Marine called Chesty Puller. He's one of the more famous Marines. And this is the Marine Corps birthday month. So a lot of the attendance words are going to be about Marines this month. Anyway, I would rather end it a little bit early on a Friday than start mutations and not be able to finish it. So we are done. I'll be in my office hours at least until noon if you need me. Let's hope it recorded. Says it. Says so. We'll see.